He's going to give a lecture about FAIR data principles, and hopefully he is able to create a presentation which follows these rules too, meaning that the speaker is finding a way to make the talk accessible for people from multiple disciplines by providing interoperable components which can be reused for own research. He's often busy, but will always find the time to help or talk to you. His knowledge consists of data structures and data integration, but he knows much more than that. He's the problem solver we all need, the coordinator of the IT and software development in Quebec. Sven Villiger, the virtual floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you, Marissa, for the very kind introduction. I'm still trying to share my screen. I had some security restrictions. I hope that you are able to see it now.
Yes.
Yes, we can.
Can you confirm perfectly? And you can obviously also hear me. I was getting a little bit nervous because Apple disallowed me from sharing my second screen, but it seems to work now. Okay. Thank you very much for the invitation and giving this talk today. It's not my primary field of expertise. I'm more at home regarding software development and software architecture. But of course, at my work at Quebec, we are very much involved into FAIR data management. And I try to give you a little bit of perspective about FAIR data management in the cancer research. And as Sven already said in the introductory slides, that the FAIR principles and the implementation of the FAIR principles are a fundamental basis to be able to perform research and reproducible research in the first place. So as preparation for this talk, I try to pin down what FAIR is about into one slide. And actually, and this is open for later discussion, that's my personal opinion, FAIR is about sharing metadata and data for science, and this ultimately and inevitably leads to adding value to the generated data because it can be reused by others for their scientific research. I tried to come up with an example use case, which is about tumor segmentation, and we will have talks about that in the afternoon session. So I picked one of these use cases, and Dale Sala et al. In 2017 stated in one of his papers about the issue when trying to segment tissue and preparing biopsies due to the heterogeneous character of tumor, and that it's always difficult to collect enough data to be able to have a statistically significant evaluation based on the data. Oftentimes, there is additional data needed to form an independent validation cohort. And if we look out for machine learning approaches to perform performance benchmarks across validation, oftentimes the data available or collected at a single research center is not enough. So the future of answering scientific questions and the life science, and this is especially true for cancer research, is impossible to solve for a single research center based on the data that it's generating by itself. So I'll try to give you a small introduction about the individual letters that stand in FAIR and to avoid panic phone calls when you recognize that you don't have enough data, basically. So as Sven already said in the beginning, that it is all about findable, accessible, and interoperable and reusable principles. And the most of you, I think, are familiar with the paper from Wilkinson et al. In 2016. These principles have a lot of implications, as you can see here in this overview graphic. For making it findable, we will see that a lot of requirements are necessary to make data sets findable. We'll also see about what it means. And to make it accessible, there are a number of implications, and with respect to the topic, we are dealing with identifying, person identifying data as well. It's important to discuss about the accessibility here. In order to make it interoperable, we will see about the roles of vocabularies and linked metadata, and of course, reusability, where metadata also plays an important role, but we will also talk about license. And this is basically what I try to scratch the surface today, and I'm very well aware of it, that it will be not enough time to go too deep into detail, but hopefully will give some of you a little of impulses to look more deeply into it, or maybe even you will learn something new today. So definable in FAIR, what does it actually mean? So the FAIR guiding principles state in their first specialization of this topic that metadata are assigned a globally unique and persistent identifier. To be able to implement this requirement, you need to know in the first place what an identifier is actually meaning and what a good identifier is. And this is actually not so trivial as it might appear in the first place. So to give a very formal definition, an identifier is basically a sequence of characters that identifies an entity. And to give you a life science example, if you go to UniProt, the actual encoding identifier for the lysine 63 specific, the ubiquitinase for PRACAR36 subunit is basically has this nice local identifier P46736. So you could state, okay, I have my identifier, should be easy to find this protein when I provide this identifier. So to have a proof of concept, I basically hit this, put this identifier into the Google search, and this is what you can end up with. So of course you will find the UniProt results, but that's not exclusively true. You will also find different hits, and one of them I picked out here, which is simple sunglasses. So, I mean, obviously you know that it's not what you were searching for, but think also not only as a human being, but also from a machine perspective. A machine does not know what you actually searching for. So if you provide only a local identifier without any additional context, your machine result could actually retrieve the wrong content. So this is a small, a little funny maybe example to that local identifiers are not sufficient to uniquely identify the resource, especially in the internet. So to give you a very small overview about what a good identifier is, and there are actually publications out there, especially with focus on identifiers in the life science. I added a reference in the bottom of the slide to those of you who want to read more about it. And a good identifier basically provides a full uniform resource identifier. And what a uniform resource identifier basically contains is that it provides a scheme that's basically the protocol. So the specification of the language, how to interact with the target resource provider. So all of you are familiar with URLs that you can enter in the browser, and they provide the standard scheme HTTP or the secure version of it, HTTPS, which is encrypted. And this is basically nothing else than a specification protocol, how to talk between your internet browser and to the server and how this information is exchanged. Then we have the host basically, which is the target resource instance, which is a resolvable address that can be translated into an IP address and will give you the unique instance in the internet to access to. And then we have the path. Basically, that is the local identifier you have just seen before. And if you enter that full URI in your browser, you will be able to directly find the correct research, and you will be prompted with the UniProt entry. So this is a very simple example, but I think it nails it down to the point what a globally identifier basically means. So it needs to be unique with respect to the internet. It's not sufficient that it's unique in your local database or even your local organization. I jumped over some of the other findable principles to come to one that I particularly find very interesting to talk about, and that is that metadata and data is registered or indexed in a searchable resource. And what does that basically mean? So in to separate this this domain, basically you can distinguish between a centralized versus a federated infrastructure approach to provide access to research data. And one of the most prominent and famous examples here with respect to cancer research as an example for centralized infrastructure is the GDC provided by the National Institute of Health, the Genome Data Commons, which basically took a lot of effort to combine data, so clinical data and treatment data based on target and the TCGA data sets, and combines it on a single data portal and makes it able to search for particular data sets with respect to cancer and to access it and to download it. It uses a number of different data models. They implemented them by themselves. So the NIH comes with a huge framework for describing these entities. So they basically come up with their own ontology that is based on CDEs, the common data entities, metadata model they single-handedly came up with. As preparation for this talk, I tried to look into it. So, this is really huge. The ontology file itself is about 1 gigabyte big, and I successfully managed to crash my MacBook. Several times I tried to investigate the file with software that is dedicated to ontology creation. It's very big. It's very detailed, and you can utilize it to facilitate dataset search against the programming interface the GDC data portal provides with. This is basically an overview about the centralized infrastructure approach. So you as a user would perform a request to the data repository, which is the GDC, and to be able to do that, the prerequisite is that the local data center that generated the data have transferred the original data to a data repository. In this case, it's TCGA, in order to make it findable via the GDC portal interface. This is a centralized approach, and it has its benefits. One of the biggest benefits is that if you collect the data at a single point, single organization, you are able to process the data in a common way. We speak of harmonized data processing, and we will see later in Enrique's talk about maybe best practices, pipelines for processing that. And of course, you'll be able to guarantee a certain quality of metadata. Not saying that it is easy. This is a tedious work to do, but this is what they have done. And of course, what is provided is of very high quality. The advantage is also that you have a single point of entry. So if you want to search data sets with respect to cancer and you want to find additional data to form a validation cohort, for example, you know where you have to go for in order to search it. One of the disadvantages is that creating such a central data repository is usually very expensive to maintain. You have huge data traffic condensed in a single place or in a single region, which is usually forming a physical bottleneck at some point. And also you provide a single point of failure that is very difficult to set up and maintain to guarantee that the single repository is not, it's basically not falling out. In contrast to that, you can have a federated infrastructure. And as an example, I took the GH4GA beacon that might be known to some of you, or even some of them have looked into the specification. So what it is about is it's about genetic mutation sharing. And the idea is basically that the data is hosted on every location and data center, and it's not centrally aggregated. And you provide a web service and an API that basically provides search queries and search query results for specific mutations. And you will basically then guarantee as a local data center that you have implemented this search interface and that you will provide the respective result up on query. And what you do then as a user, you will perform the query on a single registry, but the registry is just a single simple web server that will then basically redirect the request to all available beacon nodes in this case. And and even if one of the beacons is offline again, you will still be able to get some hit results. One of the advantages is, of course, that you have your maintenance distributed, also your traffic load. One of the disadvantages is, of course, you have no real control about how the data is processed at the single data centers, which pipelines have been used to generate the actually findings of the mutations that have been observed on the sites. And in this case of the GH4GA beacon, of course, at least as I found out in the last days of the checking the specifications again, there is no opportunity, at least I did not find it, to exchange raw data access. But that was not the primary focus of this work. Preparing this talk, I was then wondering, what about a semantic web and linked data idea that has been around since the beginning of the internet, and why not utilizing it for life science data? And to basically originate that idea that is not based on life science, but of the inventor of the World Wide Web himself, Tim Berners-Lee. He already stated in 2001 that the semantic web will enable machines to comprehend semantic documents and data, not human speech and writings. And I found this pretty amazing that the idea of connecting data and give it meaning originates back to very long time. And yeah, there are solutions already out there, and some of them are already applied in life science as well. And one of them is an official specification that is not bound to life science specifically, but we will see that there are initiatives from the life science that will extend on this initiative, which comes from the World Wide Web Consortia itself. You can find it on schema.org, which comes with a very straightforward, simple syntax. It's very clean and concise. Some of you will recognize this notation as JavaScript object notation, the ones of you who have dealt with web data exchange already. This format is very old, is very simple. And this has been used in the JSON LD, the JSON linked data implementation, and it adds basically some important properties, and one of them is the context. Context is the fundamental basis to make sure that humans, but also machines, are talking about the same thing. And with this context annotation, you basically direct, in this case, both humans and machines to a particular description that will state about what the context is about. So that basically, in this case, if we're talking about a data set, if we have several instances of these data sets, that a machine knows that this is basically the same type of data set. And this is true if you check the schema.org context and search for the type data set. you will see that there are properties given already and described what they should contain. Some of them you will find that they are mandatory, you need to provide, some of them are optional. And as preparation for this talk, I simply created an example data set that with some arbitrary data, which of course is not real, but I think you will get the picture of it. This took me like 5 minutes to set it up, and it will basically lead to if the address would be real, for example, to an AWS instance, an S3 bucket that will host the data. It says also something about the creator, which is of type person, and this person has a name, of course, and so you can nicely describe it. And this is easy to read as a human being, and also for a machine, this is straightforward to process and aggregate. Out of curiosity, I wanted to know how good this annotation works, and Google itself provides a rich result validation test. What I basically did is I passed this manual annotation for a fictional data set into the validation. That was surprising nice to see that using the schema.org dataset annotation provided me with a Google rich result test. This means basically that a search engine, in this case Google, will be able to find a data set based on the annotation I've provided. To give you an example about how this works in life science, there is an initiative called Bioschemas, which is promoted and funded via the Accelerate and Elixir project. That is basically extending the schema.org initiative for life science specific entities. And that's actually already used by the European Genome Phenome Archive, open data from Amazon AWS, and the COVID-19 data portal, which is also an EU project, and some of you may have already visited it. Surprisingly, I checked this website again with this rich metadata validator from Google. It was surprisingly, it was a little bit frustrating, to be honest, because I expected these big initiatives to properly implement it, Bioschemas, but unfortunately, through the web server settings they had, I was not able to confirm that they provide a rich result metadata that can be indexed by search engines, most probably because for one of them, I'm sure, for the COVID-19 data portal, that they blocked web crawlers that goes out to the internet and scan websites for content and index them. That's the fundamental basis for an internet search engine to work. Make your own opinion about that. I found it quite interesting to go through the source code and find out that it's not implemented properly. But in theory, this is available. This works. And go to schema.org and check out the bioschemas. It's actually growing and quite an alternative to use. As I said, you can use Google Dataset Search when you have properly annotated your datasets, and I did that for an example project representing patient data from a British birth cohort, which is publicly available, and you are able to find it and will be redirected to the European Genome Archive homepage, and confirming the hypothesis that they really implemented the schema.org annotation such that it was available. I was a little bit curious because based on the rich text result, I would have not been able to do so, but I don't know. It still worked in this case, it's not a big deal actually to set this up as a web developer. But good alternative to know. To come to the accessible in FAIR, Sven already mentioned in the beginning, one of the most occurring misconceptions is that the accessible in FAIR means that it's open, and this is not true. You can have two modes of accessibility. Either you have an open access or you have a gatekeeper access controlled data source, which we see usually for patient related data that is identifying patient and cannot be de-identified, such as full genomes, for example. And there usually what we find is that there are data access committees and that basically will provide access to the data up on an application request. Most of the standard protocols that are used, which are open, is HTTPS for authentication, OAuth for authorization. So every one of you who uses the Google account or Facebook account to log in somewhere uses this protocol without maybe knowing. OpenID doing both authentication of a person and authorization. Authorities, once you are familiar with this ORCID, LinkedIn, and of course identity providers are universities itself. And one of the infrastructures you might have known, it's getting more important for transnational data sharing, is the Elixir authentication and authorization infrastructure. And that will also play an important role through access of genome data provided in the upcoming German Genome Phenome Archive infrastructure. But this means that data is controlled. You can find the data sets by the metadata, but in order to access it, you must go over the data access committee. So accessible does not mean is equally open. However, the FAIR guidelines explicitly state that you must describe the procedure, and ideally you do that in a way that it's machine actionable, such that you know how to be able to access the data. Yeah, last but not least, the interoperable and reusable in FAIR. And in order to do so, you need rich metadata, and rich metadata can be achieved by providing controlled vocabulary, as you most of you are familiar with. And for that, we have ontology frameworks that are more or less human readable, but in any case, machine readable. And it's fundamental basis how an ontology is formed, that you basically have always this triplet description, which is subject, predicate, object. So you have describe an entity as a subject and some kind of interaction with another one, which is then the object. And this triplet forms the fundamental basis of ontology frameworks. Some of them you already might know, which is FHIR, or from the National Institute of Health, you have NCIT. Both of them are huge and big. These of you that have dealt with it know that it's not straightforward to work with them. The specifications are huge and not easy to read, but they cover, of course, a lot of use cases. They are there for quite some time. An instantiation, if we go back how the ontology can be formed, would then be, in this case, I put myself as a person, and the predicate would be works at, and the object would be cubic. And this is a totally valid ontology description, how it works. In order to describe that in a machine readable notation, you have a lot of standards out there, which is the JSON linked data we have already seen before. We have the ontology, the web ontology language from the World Wide Web Consortium. We have the resource data framework, which is also out there in the internet for quite some time. And you can utilize these languages to guarantee to describe your data properly.
Ben, can I interrupt for a small sec?
Yeah, Marisa.
Is it possible that you wrap up your presentation?
Sure.
Okay, thank you.
Two slides left, actually. So for the ontologies in cancer research, as I said, for electronic health records, one prominent example is FHIR, the Fast Healthcare Interoperability Resource. With case report forms, you most probably have been in contact with or had to deal with REDCap. And the GDC comes up with its own ontologies that they build up. if you want to find out more about ontologies in cancer research, I recommend to try out the EBI ontology lookup service that I've linked in the presentation. Yeah, last but not least, the ISA framework, which I find quite interesting for data centers that have to deal with metadata cross-domain on a cross-domain level. Its core set provides a feature-rich ontology to describe study and experimental design. And if you want to go specific to your local scientific domain, you will be able to reference external ontologies, which I find a quite flexible approach to deal with when you need to make the choice about which ontology framework you need to choose. Last but not least, the last slide is about data usage. And in order to reuse data, you must provide a data usage license. This is not only true for software, but also for all other kinds of data. And this means if you do not provide a license, a usage license, that basically infers for other researchers that they cannot use the data because of unknown licensing. Example licenses for data that can be open accessible is the Open Data Commons Attribution License or the Creative Commons, which most of you most probably know from images. And for access control data, usually this is then part of the data owner and the data access committee to provide specifics about the license and the usage of the data that is not can be not specified in a broad manner. It will be different from data access committee to data access committee, but FAIR states that the data usage license must be provided with the data to enable the best practices. And that's it from my side. It would have not been a fair talk if I do not provide a globally unique and persistent identifier for this presentation, and you will find it on Zenodo. Try to come up with licenses for all of the images, and I thank you very much for your attention. And I will be available now and later, of course, in the breakout session if you have further questions.
Thank you very much, Sven. So maybe we have time for one more question before we're going for the lunch break. Is there somebody who would like to ask Sven something regarding FAIR principles? So if not, then I can ask a question. So Sven, you actually looked into the different oncology-based databases and played around with it. What would be your suggestion to improve these instances?
Yeah, what I actually was missing is good documentation and tutorials about how to apply them. So if you have to crawl through the specification, it's really cumbersome to actually utilize it. Especially when I try to utilize the National Cancer Institute vocabulary, it was frustrating for me. So I tried to deal with it and build an own ontology using the ontology vocabularies. But tutorials would be really nice. Personally, I would most probably go for a more slim approach. So S-Cubic that deals with not only cancer research data, but we are cross-domain data center. ISA is definitely something we already have looked into it and most probably will support further as it's quite flexible and can be extended from ontologies of other domains if we need so.
Thank you, Sven. So again, thank you for the great talk.